Welcome to the Arkansas Wildlife Podcast, the official podcast of the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission. We are talking hunting, fishing, and conservation with engaging guests and in-depth discussions with game and fish staff. It's Arkansas Wildlife, the podcast for all things outdoors in the natural state.
Welcome to the Arkansas Wildlife Podcast. I'm Trey Reid from the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission, joined today by Ben Batten on my left here. He is Deputy Director at Arkansas Game and Fish, and Matt Schroeder, who is, for lack of a better term, he's the Lake Conway biologist. District Fisheries Biologist at Arkansas Game and Fish, but his district includes Lake Conway, and if you haven't already guessed it, we made a big announcement last week about a renovation, probably the single largest infrastructure project in the agency's history, on one location at least, biggest fisheries project probably ever, hands down. That was just a week ago, and had some had a public meeting earlier this week, and another one later in the week. I know you could be listening to this podcast at any time, but we're going with our drop date, which is Wednesday, and so a lot of talk, a lot of talk about what's going on with Lake Conway. It is big news, and so that's what we're going to be talking about today. And I have got two guys. Ben came up through the fisheries division at Arkansas Game and Fish before becoming deputy director. And as I said, Matt is the guy that's the eyes and ears on the ground, in the water, toes in the water out there on Lake Conway, checking water temperatures. No two better people really to talk about this project. Let's start with a question that I'm sure is on everybody's mind. Why and why now?
Well, this has been a project that we've talked about for a long, long time, trying to get our ducks all in a row and get everything planned out. It's something that's been needed for a long time. Lake Conway is 75 years old. It's aging. Infrastructure is getting old. It's not as productive as it once was. Even though it does have a good fishery, it's got some issues. And so it's time to take care of some problems, and the time is right.
Yeah. Ben, what would you add to that?
Well, I'd say, you know, this is not a easy problem to handle. This is a big, complex project, and I really appreciate, I know we've covered some things on the show before, but we're at an era in Game and Fish right now, which for a guy who's been working here 14 years, it's really exciting. We're not siding around, we're not kicking cans, we are going headlong at our biggest problems. We're investing the funds, the time, et cetera, to get it done. Got a director who's all about that. Commission's lined up, they're supportive. And it makes it really exciting to do these big things. So knowing we're going to need to do this major dam and spillway infrastructure project, we decided early on, again, mostly director's vision, we're going to do everything we can do in the watershed at that time to make it better.
I was going to kind of separate, there's a lot of components to this. I want to break it down. We'll go deeper, like the branches of the tree, but let's go the two big ones, infrastructure and the fishery. You mentioned infrastructure, the dam, 75 years old. What's going to happen there?
Well, basically the existing structure is going to be modified into a, what they call a labyrinth or a weir spillway, which increases the surface area. And so effectively makes it like it's a much longer spillway. The gates are going to be removed from it. And then there's going to be a secondary structure spillway also built in that's going to also increase the surface area and discharge rate. And because of that, we're not going to have to draw the lake down in the wintertime anymore. And so it'll be able to remain at 263 year round.
So it sounds like you're going to be able to evacuate more water without manual use of the gates. And
right. Yeah. Yep. So it'll take any human error out of the equation, which is important.
Okay. All right. Now, on. Okay, we could just go in and build a cofferdam and replace the dam, and you've still got a fishery there. So why are we taking that next step, Ben, to you know, basically hit reset?
Yeah, you know, a lot of people don't think about this, but sediment or, you know, soil going into watersheds is the number one pollutant in the state of Arkansas. And after 75 years, we've lost right about one third of the depth and the, you know, fish habitat in Lake Conway. So probably, arguably, the biggest and best thing that we can do here is take steps to allow that soil to dry out over a couple or several good, hopefully hot, dry summers. Let that bake out. And it actually, you know, that type of soil will harden up and doesn't necessarily just expand right back. It'll actually turn it to a hard bottom again, grow vegetation. And we're going to hopefully gain a significant volume of the lake back.
Yeah, I was one of the we've lost what we think. I mean, and it's an estimate, but an estimate based on sound science, 30 to 40% of the volume of the lake in acre feet.
Yeah,
over 75 years.
That's correct. It started out about 40,000, and I believe we're looking at that FTN study from 2015, I think, and they estimate we lost 13,000 out of 40,000 acre feet. So think about that. That is, 13,000 times 1 foot of water, that many acres.
Wow.
It's a huge amount. And right. Every, you know, productivity is based on how much open water and, you know, water you have. And so it's majorly decreasing fish habitat.
So this soil compaction, you know, all that. Before we get into that, I want to talk, because hard to believe, but in the last just few days, I've had numerous conversations. One at Bates Field and Stream this morning. I'm wearing my fishing clothes because I was actually out on Lake Conway. If you're watching this on YouTube, out on Lake Conway this morning, and stopped at Bates Field and Stream. A couple of guys walked by at the ramp, and I think one question that those that, you know, may not as, you know, be as involved in this or get down as deep as we do on this. Like, why is all that sediment there? Why has it become such a problem?
So, you know, if you think about, you see a riverbank that's eroded away or things like that. Also development, you know, human activities end up increasing the amount of sediment that goes in to any watershed. This happened across the state everywhere. Now, when you put a dam in, that naturally means that water is able to flow over, but it slows the water enough down, the sediment runs through the stream, gets the lake, and just falls out. And that's how it's gotten there.
What about development around Conway? You're from that area, right, Matt? Right. I mean, you've been born and raised and lived there most of your life. I mean, I'm sure just in your lifetime, you've seen the rapid development. I mean, I don't know what the population of Conway was when the lake was built in 1948, but I can't imagine it was more than probably 10,000 people. And now you're knocking on the door of 100,000. Lots of concrete, lots of asphalt, and lots of water moving fast without the dirt falling out.
Oh, that's right. And just when I was in school at UCA in the late 90s, the population has nearly doubled now. And so it just shows
you. Just in 25 years,
that's
basically.
Right. Yep.
Wow. All right. So let's talk about the solution to that. The compaction, you get, hopefully, you know, you get grasses growing up, you get bushes growing up, you get a lot of natural plant material. What does that do when the water comes back?
Well, one of the big things, so with the soil consolidation, one of the other things is that all that organic material, so we have alligator weed, we've got all these lily pad species, things that we have to try to treat. And so not only is that soil compacting, but you also get oxidation of organic material, which causes it to break down. And so that's going to also increase the depth. But so that's one thing that's happening. But then you also have the terrestrial vegetation that starts growing up. It starts uptaking the nutrients from the soil. And so once that terrestrial vegetation then floods, you'll get those natural nutrients back into the water column.
All right. And we're not going to just solely leave it to Mother Nature, the sunshine, the dry, the hot summer, the soil compaction. But tell me about the plans for placing new fish habitat into the lake.
Yeah, there's so obviously Lake Conway has got an abundance of stumps. It does have some cypress trees, which are pretty complex structures, but stumps, once they start decomposing, there's not a whole lot to them.
Yeah, you know, I didn't catch a single fish off one of those millions of stumps this morning, Matt.
Right, yeah. And so if you look at a cypress tree, a live cypress tree underwater, it's got a very complex root system that comes up basically the same diameter as the canopy of the tree. And so stumps do not have that. And so we want to replicate more of that natural stuff, more complex habitat. So we're going to be putting in hinge cutting trees off the bank. We're going to be making natural structures out of cedar trees, things of that nature. We're going to come in with a bunch of artificial structures. And the goal is to have roughly 3,000 pieces of structure, which would end up being about 300 or so habitat sites. let's see, pea gravel spawning beds.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that. I mean, because that's kind of a, I mean, we hear about the hard substrate the fish need to spawn on. There's really none of that in Conway.
Right. And there
I don't know. There may be some.
There are
but
it's limited. And so, and I've heard people say, if you put pea gravel on top of the muck, it's just going to get sunk in. Well, you basically are building a box with a liner, and so it does not have a way to sink in through the mud.
Okay. Yep. All right.
And I have to say, so our chief of staff, Chris Racy, and I went to Poinsett a few weeks ago. And besides the fact that we caught 115 lovely brim out there, as we were pulling out, we saw a couple fishing one of the pea gravel beds we put in right there at the boat ramp. And in probably 10 minutes, I watched them catch four fish right
out
there.
Wow. Yep. I mean, programming note, we should probably say you didn't keep all 115, did
correct.
You?
Correct.
I mean, okay.
No, right. We kept about 30.
I want to get back to Poinsett and some other lake renovations, but I want to kind of get to through some more particulars on this Lake Conway project. We've talked about habitat structures. I know we did a survey a few years ago and found out that basically half of the anglers in Arkansas never use a boat to go fishing. No kayak, no canoe, no power boat. They fish from the bank. Lake Conway's got some pretty good bank access, but this project includes bank access, some boat ramps, some facilities improvements. What can y'all tell us about that?
Yeah, and backing up that that statewide bank angler survey, we had a creel survey on Lake Conway. And it confirmed the same thing. Bank angling was actually a lot higher on Lake Conway than boat angling was, which is interesting.
There are more public use of Conway that is higher for bank access than it is boat access.
So that's important to us. And we've known that for a little while, just anecdotally, but this study confirmed it. And so we plan on, at all the access areas, putting in these areas that make it more inviting to fish. We're hoping to provide more shade. More structure closer to the bank, deeper water that, you know, attracts more fish.
Get into that deeper water. I mean, because I think people would be interested to, you know, I've seen some of the schematics. Right. And hey, if you want to find out more about this project, it's probably a good time to tell you newlakeconway.com is a great site where you can find out a lot of, you know, see some of the things we're talking about. But what does that look like actually, Matt?
And so a challenge is that if you were just to dig a hole in a lake bed, eventually it's going to fill back in with silt. And so we've got to engineer it in a way that we've got some kind of sediment dikes, kind of like what you see on the Arkansas River, that encourages flow to go a certain way. And so it's going to keep it kind of scoured on the backside. And so we're going to have to do some engineering like that. And we're going to relate it close enough to the bank where it benefits bank anglers.
Yeah, so you're going to, there'll actually be like levees or jetties that project out into the lake. And so you'll have deeper areas around those because you're going to use that material from the dry lake bed to build those.
We hope to. We hope that's what we can do.
If we can get a machine in there, if it dries out enough, is that the...
Right.
While we're talking about that, I know another persistent problem over the years on Lake Conway are boat lanes. 23 miles of boat lanes, 22 of those may have stumps. where the markers have shifted or they weren't, you know, completely cleaned out 50, 60 years ago, whatever. What does that look like?
That's going to be an extensive project. We've got some good ideas. We're working through some of the details, but basically it's going to require a contractor or two to come in and either knock them down and dig them out with an excavator, basically, in a dry lake bed, and then come back and remark them. And what we have in mind is that certain areas, the boat trails will be wider for, say, for an example, a tournament type style boat takeoff where they need a little extra room, and then it'll narrow back up. But we don't want to turn it into an interstate where people are driving unsafe. We still want folks to be safe.
There's still going to be a whole lot of stumps in that lake no matter what.
Right.
I'm sorry, Ben, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, I talk to lots of folks, you know, on a weekly basis in Central Arkansas. Oh, I'd never put my boat in there. I'm, you know, those kind of horror stories. And once you get out of the boat lane, you better be on a trolling motor or idling. But we want to make it to where you can comfortably travel in the boat lane and not be worried you're about to knock your prop off.
All right, so let's get into some questions, some of the ones I've been hearing. One of them I got this morning, a guy said, can I go out in the lake when it's drawn down? What are the rules going to be there?
So it's at your own risk to go out into the lake on your feet. We don't want folks driving out in UTVs, ATVs, things of that nature out into the lake bed to do whatever. The exceptions are that we're fine with you using some fairly small equipment around your property to do some work along the shoreline or maybe even deepen out around your pier or boathouse. And that's about it. And there may be a couple exceptions along the way, but
we're going to do some stuff as well. My understanding, probably some public effort, right? Like bringing people in, asking for volunteers to, you know, maybe help build fish habitat structures, help plant cypress trees. So there may be an opportunities for people to help out in that way, right?
Well, there's tons of debris in the lake too and trash. So we'll definitely be hosting probably like kind of community based out of the different access areas. I can see days where we'll get a big dumpster down there and get as many folks as we can on the ground to come help us clean.
I have gotten the sense from talking to folks in the Mayflower and Conway area that there's, I think some people just want to go on scavenger hunts out there.
Absolutely. Like,
we had a contest for the oldest fishing lure that anybody can find out there.
Who knows what all's in there?
When there's been some tornadoes in the area too that have probably dumped some additional debris from who knows where over the years.
Yep. Absolutely.
All right, so I don't know. What have we not covered about, like, the project, the renovation of the lake? You know, we've talked about habitat. We've talked about, you know, soil compaction. We've talked about some facilities. Is there anything I've missed?
I want to expand on the access areas a little bit.
Yes.
We hit bank angling pretty hard, which is great, but I want to talk about boat access as well. We're definitely looking at plans to potentially expand some of the ramps, cut some stumps that might be between where a boat ramp is and you get to the, you know, to the boat lanes and things like that. But also we're considering putting in a tournament weigh-in style facility. Most likely we're looking at Pierce Creek and, you know, don't lock us in. We could find somewhere else that's more suitable, but would like to be able to host a little bit larger events. You know, I've fished lots of little club tournaments out there, 20, 30 boats, but it'd be nice to have something that could do maybe double that.
And then when you're talking about like a pavilion, more parking spaces, I think I saw a dedicated kayak and canoe launch as part of a potential Pierce Creek enhancement.
Yeah, that's something we're trying to do at a lot of places. As you see a little bit of conflict between people launching a motorboat and people tying up the ramp with canoes, kayaks, and things like that. So what we're doing all around the state is making dedicated spots where you can be out of the way and slide something in and keep traffic flowing.
All right, so let's talk about why this is a good idea. Benny, I'm going to steal your thunder. I'm sorry, because it's the best line. You said on another radio show with me recently, I know how this story ends, and it's a very good ending. how do you know that, Ben?
Or yeah,
Matt?
We now have a track record with a number of different lakes that, you know, when we come in, and again, none have been done as extensively as what we're going to do here, but even with less effort, but not quite as expansive of efforts at others, they've turned right around. And again, I was just at Poinsett, which is our most recent completed, and, you know, just was fantastic. Habitat all over the place. Like I said, we found some brim beds that were like half an acre and just couldn't quit catching fish. Caught, we weren't going to fish bass, but they started breaking on the surface. Couldn't help ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And just the schools of shad they were chasing. And those bass are just, I think, a year old right now. They were like a pound and a half. And every one of them was just fat and looked healthy as can be. So, I mean, we know it turns around. I was thinking about this for Conway. Some people, the fishery's not that bad right now. Why are you doing that? And it isn't. And I was thinking about as an angler, you know, you don't want to leave fish that you're on to go try to find new fish.
Right.
A little bit that same concept. But I can assure you it'll turn around. We'll be able to do some things with genetics, less rough fish in there that I think you're going to see. It will take some time to grow like big bass, but I think you're going to see some incredible bass come out of there.
Yeah, I mean, Florida strain largemouth. I mean, I guess to walk people through the process, once the lake fills back up, then you go with bait fish, forage, you know, different minnows, and then your bluegills and red ears. And then after that, we get the Florida strain bass, the catfish, and some of those other species.
Correct.
Well, another you know, success story we find in southern Arkansas, White Oak Lake. I mean, we're what, a decade, 12 years out from that renovation. Much like your experience on Poinsett, I went down there to interview an angler about his experience, and we went out on the lake, and it was one of the most phenomenal bass fishing days I've ever had in my life. I mean, 10 years out, I mean, he was telling me that 5 and 6 pounders, while it's still a reason to get excited, it's not that big of a reason to get excited. not until they get to that 7, 8, 9, 10 pound range. Now on White Oak is like, that's an eyebrow lifting fish. Whereas a 5 or 6 is not, right?
I mean, yeah. And I want to say, I mean, we were starting to see some 10s and 11s even like 3 years ago.
Right. Yeah.
It really is on right now, but, yeah, I mean, it's just exciting.
Lake Monticello is another one that's not completely back online yet. Still waiting for some more water to get in there. But I believe we recently stocked some advanced Florida bass fingerlings, like 10, 11-inch fish this Correct. Summer.
Yeah. Yep, yep.
Tell me what new lake effect is, because ultimately that's what we're getting to, right? I mean, that's what we're seeking with Lake Conway, or what we're getting with Poinsett or White Oak, or hope to get soon with Lake Monticello.
So, any lake in Arkansas besides Oxbow Lakes are all man-made. And so you got to think of when a lake is first made, it is basically a valley, a lowland, something like that, a bunch of terrestrial vegetation. And we're putting a dam across a creek mouth and making it an impoundment. And so basically, when we have a renovation, it's doing that same thing, because the water it's dewatered, terrestrial vegetation is growing back up, and like we mentioned earlier, those nutrients are being resuspended into the water column as that vegetation decomposes in the water.
I want to be very careful to make comparisons, because it's a totally different system than what we're talking about with Conway or any of our game and fish lakes, but I remember going down covering Bassmaster tournaments on Lake Amistad. And I didn't cover any old Falcon, but those Rio Grande impoundments back in the late 90s, early 2000s, they were just on fire. And I had no idea, like, well, why are they so good? Well, because there'd been a 25-year drought, and they dropped those lakes for irrigation purposes in Mexico and throughout the Rio Grande Valley. And so, yeah, I mean, you've got trees that are 10, 15 years old growing up, and then it gets inundated with water again, and it's just, yep. Whew, lights out.
Yeah, you know, in the U.S., we started constructing reservoirs, you know, in the teens and 20s. It really peaked out in the 60s.
Yeah, the mid-20th century was just like, we're building dams and reservoirs everywhere. Yeah.
And you know, we're really basically not hardly building any now. But what we have is new lake effects. So these renovations give us an opportunity to have the effect of a brand new lake. And like you said, those Texas lakes that we hear so much about on this side of the border. Yeah. you know, most of the ones that are so great, now Fork is its own thing, and we don't need to go there. But most of the other ones are in places where they get drought for anywhere from 5 to 15, 20 years. And they come back and it's like a new lake, and they'll be awesome for 15 years. Then you won't hear about them for another 20 years, because it'll go back through cycle.
You know, this is a huge project. How exciting is it for guys like you that, you know, studied fisheries science in college, you worked in, you know, worked at Game and Fish, you know, I don't know, 15, 20 years each, roughly. What's it like to be able to kind of hit that reset button on a lake?
For me, it's very exciting. You know, we have talked about it basically since day one of being in the district. And so we have talked about it, thought about it for a very long time. It's like creating a new lake. You know, it's very rare these days. And so for us to be able to do that, especially on a lake like Lake Conway, is a special thing.
Again, when you think about 75 years, I mean, this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for a fish biologist or an administrator or whatever. I mean, I couldn't be more excited about this project.
What are you hearing from folks? I mean, I know not everybody's happy about this, right? I mean, what's some of the negative feedback that you've received?
You know, a lot of it is, I think it comes down to lost opportunity. I think a lot of folks see this as, well, it's a pretty big inconvenience for 5 years. And hey, I agree. You know, Lake Conway is my home.
I was going to point out, and I maybe should have mentioned that more prominently, but you know, you fish Lake Conway all the time.
That's right. It's my home lake. My office is on the southern bank of the lake. I probably fish it 20, 40 times a year. Before I had younger kids, I'd fished it a lot more, but ran limb lines for giant flathead with my son, you know, when he was younger. He caught his first crappie and bluegill and red ear and bass and everything out there. It's a very special place to me. And so I understand when folks are, you know, a little heartbroken about the possibility of what the next several years are going to be like. I feel it too. I'm going to have to adapt. I'm going to have to go to other places as well.
You know, the flip side of that coin is though, that again, it's think about 150 years, 75 years this far. We'll hope this one goes 75 years. We have to hit time out for 5 years. And that really is rough. Again, I agree with Matt. We're all human beings. And you know, talked to some folks last night, bought their house 6 months ago, wanted to retire on the lake. And gosh, that hurts my heart to hear that. But playing the long game and looking at where it's going to go, it's absolutely going to be worth it. You know, we appreciate everybody's support while we go through it, because it is tough on folks.
What... I'm trying to think of a good way to put this, but what would be the, I'm trying to get you to look into a crystal ball into the future. And let's say, all right, so it's late June, early July, of 2023. Let's fast forward. Let's say 7 years, 8 years. Okay. It's, 2031. And I'm going to tell you, y'all are both younger than me by just a little bit, but I mean, the older you get, that seems like a few days away right now. You know, when I was 20 and you said, you know, 7 or 8 years, like, oh, it's a third of my life. So I get people at different ages look at this differently, but look into your crystal ball. What do you see? How do you see a day on beautiful Lake Conway in 2031?
Well,
we're going to go springtime.
There you go. So, again, we've just come off poinsett. It's 2.5 years post-renovation. And, again, we caught plenty of hand-sized brim. Bass were, you know, not trophy, but opportunity was there. I mean, numbers were fantastic. We saw them breaking all over the place. So, at that seven-year mark that you're talking about, that's going to be where you're at. Crappie, we were catching crappie that were probably 6 inches. Here's the thing. Lake Conway today grows a 10-inch crappie in 1 year up to. So by year two of crappie stocking, we're going to have 12 and 13-inch fish. I mean, it will come back quicker than you think. Again, bass, catfish is going to be a little bit longer timeline. But in that 7 to 8 year timeline, I can expect catching lots of brim that are great if you want to keep fish. You're starting to get into good crappie. And I mean, it's...
All right, I'm going to give you a better question. Let's go 10 years for you, Matt. I'm sorry, Matt's going to take a call during the podcast.
Sorry,
it's okay. I didn't give you the warning like we normally do. Turn your phones off. It's all good. No worries. No. All right, 10 years from now, 2033, you're out on Lake Conway on a beautiful April morning.
Yeah, I'm going to say people will be catching close to 3-pound crappie, if not 3-pound crappie. That'll be the highlight for me, especially. I'm thinking by that time, largemouth bass are looking pretty good. Probably going to be seeing the, you know, 5-6 pounders by then. Abundant forage, good sized bluegill. A goal of mine has always been to grow trophy red ear. I love to catch big red ear, and I would love to see them come back on Lake Conway like that. So I think that's what we're looking at about 10 years out.
Awesome. Well, you know, I think that's a good way to end it. So many things that we do at the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission and in just the conservation field in general are require some sacrifice and some short-term hardship, pain, whatever you want to call it. But you got to remember that we're looking at things for the long haul and not just 5 or 10 years like we've been talking about today, but 10 years, 20 years, 50 years, 100 years. Those are the kind of decisions we're trying to make. In the present, and sometimes there are some inconveniences we have to go through. We've talked about it with GTRs. I mean, I you know, I'm a public land duck hunter 90% of the time, so I understand where some of those folks are coming from, but I'm very excited about what the future looks like at Lake Conway, and I know you guys are too. What anything else you want to say before we wrap things up here?
Just excited to get this going.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. How about you, Ben?
I mean, he's been talking about it for 15, 20 years.
How long have you been in that district now?
15 years.
Yeah. Okay.
Yep.
All right.
Yep.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, we're ready to go.
Yeah, just fire up the track hose.
Get to work.
Let's get to work. Guys, Ben Batten, Matt Schroeder, thank you so much for joining us here on the Arkansas Wildlife Podcast. Thank you for listening, and we'll talk to you next time right here on the Arkansas Wildlife Podcast.